Bismillah, alhamdulillah, assalamu alaikum, which is the greeting of peace. Peace be unto you. You will not find a group of people who are more inclined towards peace. Peace with their creator, peace with themselves, and peace with the rest of humanity. And those are the Muslims, ones who have consciously chosen to submit to the one true God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the creator of Jesus, Moses, Noah, and the last and final messenger sent to mankind, the Prophet Muhammad. Peace be upon him. Now, hot in the news, there are some events that are unfolding. And we're going to be talking about those events with my next guest, Sheikh Saliman. Sheikh, are you there?
Yes, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and mercy of the creator of the heavens and earth be upon you.
Barakallahu feekum.
Thank you for finding the time to be with us here on the Deen Show radio show.
I'm very happy to be with you and very honored, actually. And what I really like about this show is that it's very popular in the U.S., where I lived the best 5 years of my life when I served as the Muslim chaplain of the American University in Washington, D.C.
Alhamdulillah. So, Sheikh, talk to us. Tell us, now, it's all over the news. And we're sad to see a lot of these things unfolding like this because it's not good for the Muslims. It's not good for anybody. What's happening here in the U.S. is in Times Square, someone try to set off a bomb to hurt people. So we want to talk to the experts, and we want to invite CNN, Fox News, all the major networks to come to the experts, people like yourself and other people that we've had on the Deen Show, so we can clarify and clear any confusion. So we want to know, what does Islam have to say about filling up a car with explosives and trying to blow up innocent people? Have you heard about this story?
I heard about that story, yes. Actually, I heard about that story, and it really troubled me a lot. And whether this is done by a Muslim or a non-Muslim, Islam would never justify it under any circumstances. And the problem here, Yaakhi, happens when some people misunderstand Islamic concepts like jihad, actually. So I believe that if the person who did so happens to be a Muslim, then probably this will be because he was thinking himself doing something rightful by Islam. And he was thinking himself doing practicing jihad. But actually, the concept of jihad should be clarified for both Muslims and non-Muslims, because also non-Muslims also misunderstand the word jihad, and they think that jihad is terrorism. I personally have a personal experience with this when I was in Frankfurt a few years ago, giving some presentations on Islam in the biggest book fair in the world, which is Frankfurt Book Fair. And, you know, this is a very crowded book fair, and every day at 5 p.m. when the book fair is closing down, I can say thousands or maybe tens of thousands of people are coming out at the same time. And at the same time, this is also the rush hour in Germany, so it's very frustrating, you know, to wait for the metro or the train to take you home for about half an hour, and the trains that come, When the doors are opened, you can't find a place to step in. So there was a German journalist waiting next to me, and he told me, he approached me and he said, "Would you like me to tell you a secret?" I said, "What?" He said, "If you want to find a place on the next train, when the door opens, shout loudly saying, 'Allahu Akbar.'" Some people will leave the train. I actually, you know, as a Muslim, the Quran told me, when you are harassed by an ignorant harasser, just say peace, which means don't you know, respond to him and be peaceful. So I just ignored him.
So we're supposed to, just to interject. So even at that time, we're supposed to say peace.
Yes, of course. We don't respond to a harasser who are who is verbally harassing us by also responding to him, because the same tongue, ya akhi, that utters the remembrance of Allah and says Allahu Akbar, Subhanallah, La ilaha illallah, should not utter bad words or nasty words, actually. So just be patient and so on. So
Sheikh, please, for our non-Muslim audience, you said some Arabic words, so they don't have to go to an Arabic dictionary. Please tell us
what
you
said.
That's true.
I'm sorry. It's actually the remembrance of Allah are a way to communicate with God by keeping him in mind all the time, like saying, glory be to God, God is greater, there is no God except him, Allah, the only one true God, and so on. So if you are all the time engaged in the remembrance of God with your tongue, how come the same tongue, you know, utters maybe other bad words or nasty stuff? So it's not allowed in Islam.
Okay, great.
Not allowed at all, of course. So actually, I acted patiently towards him, and then he approached me again. He said, would you like me to tell you another secret?
He's full of secrets now.
Yeah, actually, he's German, and we're in Germany. And in the beginning, I thought that his secrets would be like, how can we get a train home at that time when it's crowded like that? And I thought that he would tell me that we can walk to a further station and take the train from there or something. But I found him telling me that when the train comes and the door is opened and we don't find a place to step in, shout loudly and say, Jihad. You will probably be the only one on the train.
Wow.
So I said, look, young man, all Muslims in the world love this word so much. And he said, what? I thought only 15%. Because that's what people are told in the West, that 15% of Muslims are fanatics, prospects, suicide bombers. And I said, no. 100% of the Muslims love this word so much. We even use it to name our children, boys and girls. Here in your country, you can find a three-year-old girl with rosy apple cheeks and blue eyes and blonde hair. And you ask her, what's your name, honey? She tells you, my name is Jihad. So Muslims even use this word to name their children. It has a very positive connotation, by the way. And then I told him, come with me and I'll explain to you what is Jihad. So the problem is when people think that Jihad equals terrorism, well, actually it doesn't. It means exactly the opposite. The word Jihad.
That's what I was going to ask you next. If you can define, because many people have the word Jihad, when they hear it, they feel it equals terrorism. They feel like, the boogeyman's coming to get me, that these people are coming to take my liberty, take my freedom. Jihad is on the way. You better run and hide. Can you define what Jihad actually means?
Okay. Let me tell you that when we define any Arabic word or actually any concept in Islam, we have to define it linguistically and then idiomatically. Linguistically, the word Jihad comes from the root of the word jaha. De in the Arabic language, which means exerting extra effort. So we can say that linguistically the word Jihad means striving and struggling. Idiomatically, the word Jihad has three main meanings. The first one is spiritual Jihad, which is a non-violent struggling against oneself to live a life of virtue. You struggle against your ego to be a better person. To wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning and wash your face, hands and feet and go to pray while people are in their cozy beds, that's not easy, that needs Jihad. To spend in charity without showing off, that's not easy. To do such a thing with sincerity, this needs Jihad. Some Muslims even went to the extent that even the poor people themselves did not know who is sending them the money. There's a very lovely story about this in the Islamic history, that the poor people of Medina used to receive food and provisions to their doors under the darkness of the night every night. And in the morning when they opened their doors, they find it. And they never knew who was doing so until he died and the provisions ceased to come. And that was Imam Ali Zain al-Abidin, the great grandson of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace be upon him.
He was doing the jihad, the struggle.
Exactly. So actually, can you imagine this? That you're giving someone who lives in the neighborhood money every day, bringing him food every day, and you may even deal with him during the day and he doesn't show any respect to you. But you're the one who's giving him every day because you want to do this for the sake of Allah only, not for the sake of anything, not even waiting for a thank you. This is a jihad. That's not easy. The second meaning actually is verbal jihad. You speak against evil, you speak against tyranny, and in some countries, when people say the truth, they can find themselves in jail. And Islam at this point doesn't tell people to stay quiet in order to be safe. Actually, no, Islam encourages Muslims to speak up and stand for the truth, and even if this can put their life at risk. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, if the time comes that you see my nation afraid of telling a tyrant that he's a tyrant, then there is no hope for them. And what do tyrants do, ya akhi? What do tyrants do, brother? Tyrants kill.
Yes.
And the Prophet is still encouraging us to speak against tyrants, even if this can cost us our own life, because we all have to die. Die with dignity today instead of getting ran over by a car. So when you speak the truth, things can change, and change can be possible when people, you know, speak the truth. He also said that the best martyr is the one who was killed by a tyrant for criticizing his tyranny. This means also that all these movements, you know, who speak against tyrants, they are practicing a form of jihad. All those anti-war movements and all those, you know, legal, right organizations who are standing for the rights of people and the civil rights of people, they are practicing a form of jihad. The third meaning, which is the very controversial one, and of course, it is the concept which is causing the whole concept of jihad to be by far the most misunderstood Islamic concept, is the concept of combative jihad, which is qital, called in Islam, in Arabic, qital, which is combat to establish justice.
Now, is this the jihad that you go out killing people who are not of your faith, where they say, oh, this jihad is to kill the non-Muslim, the infidels? Is that what it's all about?
This is the misconception, actually. Actually, this kind of jihad, the combative jihad, is never against people based on from which faith they are or on their religious background. It can be launched against Muslims, by Muslims too. And this is crystal clear in the Quran. In one of the chapters of the Quran, which I can bring you now, if you give me a moment.
So a Muslim can do jihad against another Muslim?
Of course. Jihad is against the aggressors, not against people because of they are from a certain faith. And I'll get you the...
Let me paint a scenario. If I'm sitting at home minding my business, mm-hmm. I'm glorifying the Creator, I'm with my family, I'm eating a halal Kentucky Fried Chicken, and somebody busts down the door, or they sneak in through the window, and they're trying to harm me and my family, rather it be a Muslim, a non-Muslim, it don't matter who, I have a right to strive and struggle, jihad, against that individual?
Sure. Of course. This is a legal right, and right given to you by the Islamic legislation too. But what I mean here is even combat itself. There is a verse in the Quran in chapter number 49, verse number 9, that says, and if two groups among the believers fall to fighting, then reconcile between them both. But if one of them still rebels against the other, then fight you all, here, this is jihad, against the one that which rebels until it complies to the command of Allah, which means that jihad here is launched by Muslims against a group of Muslims, because they are oppressors, because they are aggressors. So the back to the meaning itself, combative jihad actually is the third form of jihad, which is causing all these controversies. And I believe this is because people don't understand that it's not done haphazardly. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, mentioned clearly in his sunnah, and the sunnah means the traditions of Prophet Muhammad, since you have a lot of non-Muslim listeners, he mentioned the combat orders, which we can also call the code of combat in Islam. Number one, the rule number one is never kill innocent people. In Islam, we have 90 main rulings. Among them is this one. No one can be fought except a combatant.
Combatant.
No one can be fought except a combatant.
So someone who's not a combatant, let's say if we talk about the Times Square incident.
Exactly. That's not justified. That's why I said, of course, it cannot be justified. Akhi, this is terrorism. What is terrorism? It is killing innocent. It's not actually, this also will lead us to another also problem, which is terrorism is not defined until today. In 2005, 150 monarchs and presidents, they met in a summit in the United Nations for 2 days, and they were supposed to define terrorism for us because it's the biggest crime. And we're all the time warning the youth from falling into terrorism. But guess what? It's not defined until today. So let's try to define it together. Some people would say that terrorism is killing civilians, which is not accurate, because what if someone targeted civilians and he harmed them, but not one of them died? So he did not kill. Still, it is terrorism. So it's more accurate to say targeting, not killing, because this will apply also if no one dies. Saying civilian is also not accurate, because some civilians can be legitimate targets in war sometimes, and those are the armed civilians called militia. So in some wars there were militia who are involved. Here they can be legitimate targets sometimes in some wars. So saying targeting non-combatants is more accurate. But what if someone kills his wife? He targeted a non-combatant. Since there is no political agenda involved, then this is just a crime, but not it's not terrorism. And so we can say that to define terrorism according to academia. And here I would like to mention Dr. Robert Pape, whom I entered into some discussions with him, and with someone else called Dr. Philippe Sands, who's British. A British lawyer, by the way, who happened to be Jewish. And we spoke about it a lot, and we came up with this definition.
Yes.
Terrorism is targeting non-combatants to push a political agenda. I think now it's very clear why the world leaders were unable to define terrorism in 2005. I think they did not fail to define terrorism. Mm-hmm. It's just that if had they defined it, maybe half of them should be in jail.
Yes.
So targeting non-combatants to push a political agenda, this applies on states, this applies on organizations, this applies on individuals who do this terrible sin, by the way. In Islam, this is a terrible sin.
So we condemn both. This incident, 9/11, this has nothing to do with Islam and those others who are targeting innocent civilians. It's not acceptable.
Exactly. We condemn what happened on 9/11, whether those who did it are Muslims or non-Muslims. 7/7, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Akhi, even targeting the German civilians during World War II, there are more than 50,000 German civilians who died in the bombing of Dresden. This is also not justified, even though, even if Hitler was doing the most nasty things in the world, we should not involve civilians ever. And that's That's why Prophet Muhammad mentioned this as the number one ruling. Never, he didn't say, he said exactly, no one can be fought except a combatant. This is in the Sharia, the Islamic Sharia. And this applies on anyone. Muslims, by the way, by religion, I prove that they cannot do that. Culturally, especially in the Arabic culture, it is very disgraceful for an army if a civilian is found dead in the battlefield after the war. So it's even disgraceful by culture. The third is historically, Muslims never killed civilians. And that was
historically proven.
Yes, this is actually proven by Hollywood itself. 2 years ago or 3 years ago in the famous movie that they produced, it's called The Kingdom of Heaven, talking about Salah ad-Din, Saladin,
yes,
the Muslim king who defeated the Crusaders and returned back Jerusalem to the Muslim world. At the end of the movie, after putting Jerusalem under siege for about a month, he spoke to Damien, who is the leader of the Crusaders, in the negotiations, and he told him, Damien, what are you waiting for? Surrender the city. You're dying inside. You're under siege since more than a month. So Damien said, how can we surrender the city and then you kill us all like goats? So Salah ad-Din said, no, I won't kill anyone.
The Muslim is telling him that.
Yes. And the Crusader told the Muslim king here, are you bluffing me? You won't kill anyone with all what we did 90 years ago? Because 90 years before that day when the Crusaders took over Jerusalem, they killed every single civilian inside. They killed 70,000 Muslims. And it is said 12,000 Jews were killed like goats. The historians say that the blood was flowing in the streets of Jerusalem up to the knees.
Wow.
So Salah ad-Din in the film said, I am not those men, I am Salah ad-Din, which means I won't do that because I am Salah ad-Din. But that's not true. He didn't say so. Historically, he said, I am not those men, I am Abdullah, I am the servant of Allah, which means I'm Muslim. Muslims do not kill civilians, even if their enemy did. And this is here, brings us here to the argument of Al-Qaeda. Because I debated, by the way, with seven of those people in a European country. And
who did you debate with?
Seven people who are sympathizers with Al-Qaeda.
And what happened?
They spat at me during a public talk, and they even assaulted me. And when the security came to take them out, I said, no way, please leave them, because I have to debate with them here in front of everyone. And if they prove to be right, I will give them the microphone and they will continue. And that was when I said, no one can be killed except combatants or something like that. So they said, there is a verse in the Quran that says, and this is really the main argument of Al-Qaeda. The verse says, and if you punish them, then punish them back exactly as they punished you. Or in another translation, if you punish them, then let your punishment to them be proportionate to the harm that has been done to you. And since non-Muslims killed Muslim civilians and innocents in Palestine, in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Kashmir, therefore, according to this verse, we can kill their civilians and their innocents.
That's their argument.
That's their argument. And I said, but they did not only kill our civilians. They also raped our women in Bosnia. If you think that this verse actually allows you to respond to them in the same way you were harmed, then why don't you go and rape their women? They said, no, no, we don't do that. I say, why not? Don't you think that the verse is allowing you to harm them the same way? They said, no, we don't do that because actually rape is an illegal sexual act. I said, therefore, the verse is not general. This verse equals the verse in the Bible, in the Old Testament, which also exists in the Quran, that says, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Which means that if someone blows up one eye for you, you cannot blow up both his eyes. just one eye. If someone destroys one tooth for you, you cannot destroy his 32 teeth.
That's just in the Bible. You mentioned something about the Bible.
Yes, that's in the Bible. I don't recall the chapter now. And it's also in the Quran, which I also don't recall the chapter also, but the same verse exists in the Quran.
So we don't turn the other cheek. So if someone punches me in my left cheek, I can hit him back in the left cheek, but it's better to forgive?
Well, let's deal with this after I finish this argument, because this is also, I have also to talk about this, the issue about the cheek and about forgiveness.
Gotcha.
But let's first finish this argument with the Al-Qaeda guys there, or the sympathizers. I won't say Al-Qaeda. So this verse in the Quran that says, let your punishment be proportionate to the harm that has been done to you, doesn't allow you to do everything that your enemy did. So if it's not allowing you to rape women, it's not also allowing you to kill civilians, which means you do the same amount of harm, but within the frame of the Islamic Sharia, which is the Islamic legislation, you cannot rape women even if your enemy did. You cannot kill civilians even if your enemy did, or you would be like them. Because the Quran clearly criticized Muslims when they act like non-Muslims at times, you know, when they act wrong, like times of war and stuff like that. Because in war, sometimes people say, let's do whatever we can just to win the war. And let's put morality aside. No, Islam never puts morality aside.
Not allowed in Islam. This is crystal clear.
Crystal clear. And the Prophet criticized the Muslims when he found a woman dead in the battlefield one day, and he said, this one should have not been killed. So that was clear. Also, addressing the one that you know, the verse in the Bible that you mentioned about turning the other cheek. Let me tell you, because I'm actually a graduate of a Catholic school. I learned for 12 years in a Catholic school. And I had in my school, here in Egypt, we did not have a mosque or even a place to pray. But we had a church in our school, a huge church. So I was around with Christians all the time. And I listened a lot to Christian church leaders. And all the time, my Christian friends were always wondering, and they were always confused by two verses in the Bible. The first one in the Old Testament, which people like to call it the law of Moses sometimes, or the law of revenge. It says, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. And the second one is in the New Testament, which people like to call it the concept of forgiveness of Jesus, which is, if you are slapped on the right cheek, then turn your left cheek to the one who slapped you. And my Christian friends always asked the church theologians, which one should we apply, because those two verses are contradictory. They're contradicting with each other. And the answer that I always heard is, we are Christians, and the New Testament abrogated the Old Testament. So we are actually turning the left cheek. Even though this we have never seen a Christian country turning the left cheek. Actually, Christian countries today are only slapping people on both cheeks without any reason. But let's just focus on this. Are they contradicting those two verses? And I say, no, they are not contradicting. And to explain them, I cannot explain them except from the Quran, because the Quran in chapter number 42 mentioned three verses, verse 41, 42, and 43. That are explaining that both concepts are not contradicting. The first verse says, verse number 41 in chapter number 42, it says in the Quran, and indeed, whosoever takes revenge after he has suffered wrong, against such there is no blame. Which means that no one can blame someone who decides to apply the verse, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, which people call the law of Moses in the Old Testament. On who is the blame then? The second verse, the next verse explains in the Quran. It says, the blame is only against those who oppress people with wrongdoing and insolently transgress beyond bounds, which means that the blame is on the oppressors. But what does Allah, the one true God, recommend? The verse next says, And whosoever shows patience and forgiveness, that would truly be recommended by Allah. So this means that Allah doesn't force you to forgive, but Allah recommends that you forgive. Allah is just. Allah is the absolute justice. So we cannot say that all people are forced to turn the other cheek. No, excuse me. Then there's no difference between the good and the bad, between the obedient and the more obedient and the most obedient. Here, you know, if you look at your fingers in one hand, you don't have two similar fingers to each other. Why do you think that God will deal with us as if we are just similar to each other? Some of us can forgive, and some of us may not be able to forgive. Some harm can be very deep that people cannot forgive. So here Allah is saying, there is no blame on you if you apply the first verse, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I recommend that you turn the other cheek. So this is the issue here. Here I explain to them the Bible from the Quran itself.
Does this, for somebody who's a layman, if he takes this, can he now take the law in his own hands and go ahead and implement some kind of revenge? What does Islam have to say about that?
That's excellent. That's excellent. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, if you see something wrong, then change it with your hand. If you are unable to do that, which means not authorized also, then speak against it. If you are unable to do that, which means that there is a tyrant who can kill you, maybe, okay? Then feel bad about it in your heart. But let know that this is the weakest form of faith, which means that you have to change the wrong whenever you can, which means if you are also authorized to change it. If you're not authorized to change what you see wrong with your hands, then don't do that, but speak against it.
Gotcha.
So this is crystal clear. No. No one can claim that he is the one. Actually, this is a crime in the Islamic Sharia or legislation called al-iftiat ala al-hakim, which means taking the role of the ruler while he is still there. You cannot take the role of the ruler, and apply the law yourself. No, there's a law enforcement who will do that for you, but you're not allowed to do that.
So you have to obey the law that's in place.
Exactly. So back, ya akhi, to our combat orders of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Never kill innocent people. That was number one. Number two, never torture prisoners of war.
Never torture prisoners of war. This is what Islam says.
Akhi, Islam doesn't allow torturing prisoners of war, neither physically nor psychologically. One day, the night before the Battle of Badr, which was the first battle between the Muslims under the leadership of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the pagans of Quraysh, the fiercest enemy of Islam, who give them hard time for about 15 years. And the night before that battle, very desperate to any information about the army of the enemy, an intelligence unit of three companions of Prophet Muhammad, namely Ali ibn Abi Talib, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, I think, and Zubair ibn Awam, they captured two soldiers from the army of Quraysh. And they brought them to the camp of the Muslims. And then they started beating them up to get information about the army. And Prophet Muhammad was praying, so he was troubled with what they were doing, and he ended his prayer. And he said, you are torturing them, and they are telling you nothing but lies. And he said, come here, you both of you. Take something to drink. They give them something to drink. He said, I have one question. You answer, you're out. He said, what? But the boys are very patriotic, and they don't want to disclose any information about the army. He said, how many camels do you slaughter every day? And they looked to each other, and they thought that it's a very silly question. There's no problem to answer this question and get out. So they said, sometimes we slaughter 9 camels, and sometimes we slaughter 10 camels. And then the Prophet, peace be upon him, looked at the companions, and he said, the army is between 900 and 1,000 because the camel feeds 100. Every camel can feed about 100 people. So this is the imam of investigators, the leader, the role model of every investigator. Don't use torture. Number one, it's immoral. Number two, the information that you get from torture is unreliable. And there was also another film also produced in Hollywood called Rendition. That was 2 years ago, about an American from an Egyptian descent who immigrated to the US in the age of 14. And after 9/11, they suspected that he has ties to terrorism. So the FBI took him from the airport on his way back from Cape Town or something. And because they don't torture people, they exported him to an Arab nation to be tortured there. And that was in the presence of the main character in the film. He's a CIA agent who worked in the embassy of the US in this country. And I think that the actor was Orlando Bloom, if I can remember. And the Arab officers were torturing the man the whole film. And the man is not saying anything. He's innocent. And the CIA agent told them, stop it. He's not saying anything. You will kill him. So they looked at him and they said, you're ignorant. You just sit and watch. And then all of a sudden, the man started to talk. And he admitted having ties to terrorism. He admitted that he told them how to make a bomb, a huge bomb. And when they asked him about names, he really gave them 11 names. All of them are Arabic names. And they asked him, why did he do so? He said, they paid me $40,000. And then the CIA agent took these names and he Googled the names. He found that those are the members of the soccer team of Egypt in the World Cup the year this boy left Egypt and came to the US when he was young. And then he found that he's making $200,000 a year. Why would he risk his career for $40,000? So you torture people, they lie just to get out, just to stop the torture. And that's what Prophet Muhammad said 14 centuries ago. You are torturing them and they are telling you nothing but lies.
So this is not allowed. We covered now that jihad means to struggle and strive, and for our non-Muslim and the Muslims who are listening, we're getting to learn something, and people should be very attentive because you're coming to the Muslim to learn about Islam. And that's the right thing to do. You don't want to go to Hitler to learn about Christianity. You want to come to the Muslims and those who are the scholars of Islam to learn about Islam. So now we talked about the prisoners of war. You don't torture them. People are getting a different light, a different perspective now. And I think some of the fear is getting to get eradicated. It's going away. We have a few more points that we want to cover, Sheikh. We're going to have to do a part two.
Okay, sure.
Tell us quickly what are some of these other points before I get into a few more points that I want you to cover. What was the next
point? Because actually we are talking and we're taking things like point by point. I don't want also to skip something which is even torturing prisoners of war psychologically is not allowed in Islam.
Not allowed.
Not allowed, even psychologically. And that's crystal clear in the seerah of Prophet Muhammad, in the biography of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Bilal, one of his companions, was walking two prisoners of war, and they saw their dead before their burial, they broke down, and they cried. And the Prophet blamed him, and he said, don't you have mercy in your heart, Bilal? You could have taken another route. To this extent, yeah, let me tell you something. The Quran is putting that among the characteristics that you should have in your heart in order to qualify for going to paradise is to be nice and kind to a prisoner of war. Allah says in the Quran about those who enter paradise that they are those whom out of their love to Allah, they feed the orphan, the needy, and the prisoner of war. Can you imagine this? Someone who came a day ago to kill me and to kill my wife and rape my children and take my land, the Quran is telling me, if you want to go to paradise, you have to be kind to this man. And this brings us back to the issue of spiritual jihad, because that's not easy to do so. Prophet Muhammad taught us his prophetic way of torturing prisoners. How did Prophet Muhammad torture his prisoners of war? You know, he used to jail them in the mosque. And the Muslims coming every time to pray, five times every day, they bring them dates and milk. Those who were tortured this way, they were never seen in any battle after that against Muslims, because they understood what Islam is all about. Muslims never fight driven by hatred. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, the cousin of Prophet Muhammad and the fourth caliph after Prophet Muhammad, in one of the battles he was fighting against one of the pagans, the enemies, and the man was about to kill him twice in their combat. And then finally Ali conquered him, and the man's sword was broken, and the man fell on his back. Just before killing him, the man spat at Ali's face. He said, well, I'm dying anyway. So he spat at his face. Ali ibn Abi Talib turned his back to him and he went and didn't kill him. And the man couldn't understand this. He went and he said, excuse me, what happened? We've been fighting since an hour. I was about to kill you twice, and now when you conquer me, you don't kill me? He said, look, I don't hate you. I was fighting you because I am performing jihad, which means I'm trying to establish justice here. I'm trying to get back my home in Mecca, my money that you took from me. But when you spat at my face, I felt something against you in my heart, something personal. And at this point, I cannot kill you.
Wow. That's deep.
Wow. Those are the examples. Those are the examples, not only for us, for every combatant in this world, for the American soldiers, for the Afghani soldiers, for the Egyptian soldiers. People should really look very carefully at these stories and learn, and learn.
Tell
Prophet
us,
Muhammad.
Sheikh.
Yes, yes.
Go ahead, Sheikh. I'm sorry.
I was about to mention quickly the rest of the combat orders of Prophet Muhammad that are mentioned in his traditions.
Go ahead, please, go ahead.
We mentioned, number one, never kill innocent people. Number two, never torture prisoners of war, neither physically nor psychologically. Also, never kill animals, never destroy crops. He even said an amazing tradition that I couldn't believe myself when I found it. He said, never disturb the birds in their nests.
Wow.
Some people would think that this is overdoing. No, excuse me. This is explaining to you that those people who are going out to perform jihad, they were not like lay people, savages. They were not like the crusaders in the first crusade who came through Eastern Europe and they raped and looted and put cities ablaze in Hungary and in Bulgaria, which are Christian countries. But the Christians coming in this army from Germany, from Spain, and from France, they looted and plundered and raped even Christian cities. No, here the Muslims who are involved in the army that is going to somewhere to establish justice are disciplined. Those are monks by daytime. Oh, I'm sorry, monks by nighttime and knights by daytime.
And this is for justice.
This is for justice only. It's not allowed to commit aggression in Islam. Prophet Muhammad also teachings are not allowing Muslims to destroy infrastructures. And of course, the Prophet never said infrastructures, but we are not allowed to poison wells. And poisoning the well is a destruction for the infrastructure. Prophet Muhammad's teachings include never mutilate bodies of enemies, dead or alive. In one of the battles, they caught someone called Suhail ibn Amr. He was among the captives of war. And Umar ibn al-Khattab, a great companion and a very close friend of Prophet Muhammad, and his second successor, actually the second caliph, he told him, "Oh, Prophet of Allah, good news." He said, "What?" He said, "Guess who is among the prisoners?" The Prophet said, "Who?" He said, "Suhail ibn Amr himself." And Suhail ibn Amr was actually a big speaker who speaks against Islam. And, you know, there was like media war too, which always precedes, you know, the military war. and he was the biggest enemy in this among the propagandists against Islam. So the Prophet said, okay, and what do you want me to do? He said, come on, Prophet of Allah, I'm speaking about Suhail ibn Amr among the captives. Let's get rid of him. And the Prophet said, but Umar, I don't kill prisoners of war. So Umar said, I know that, but let's not waste this chance. Only this one. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, I don't, Umar. I don't kill prisoners of war. Umar said, okay, I have an idea. And actually, if you think about it, it's a genius idea. Umar said, let's just break his two incisors, his two teeth, you know, that are in the front of the above two, in the upper jaw.
Yes.
So that when man speaks, he will speak funny. He will say, Islam, Muslims, and people will be laughing at him and won't listen to him. If you think about it, this is very simple, and we will get rid of a big propagandist. The Prophet said, no, Umar, I can't do that. I can't mutilate bodies, or Allah will be mutilating my body even if I'm a prophet. You know what happened after 10 years? After the death of Prophet Muhammad, most of Arabia apostated except three cities. One of them is Mecca, when it kept its faith following, listening to this man giving a speech about Islam, telling them, stand fast and fight for the sake of Allah and do not leave Islam. All you need to do is to stick to the Sharia, stick to the law of Allah, and never think yourself smarter than Allah. Allah said, don't mutilate the bodies of enemies, then don't mutilate them. Don't say, but this man is a very special case. Sometimes we don't understand the wisdom behind some verdicts of the Sharia. We have to stick to it, even if we don't understand the wisdom. You can understand later, and you may not understand at all, but stick to what Allah tells you, because you are not smarter than Allah. Also, among the teachings of Prophet Muhammad is houses of worship, women, children, and the elderly should be all protected from any harm.
Protected.
Actually, among the root causes of jihad, that can justify jihad, is a verse in the Quran that says, had not Allah allowed some people to fight other people, many monasteries, churches, synagogues, and mosques where the name of Allah is commemorated a lot could have been demolished, which means that jihad is allowed to protect houses of worship of other religions, even though we don't agree with them on some of their beliefs. But we are told by the Quran, fight to defend the freedom of religion of even others, not only Muslims. And the last point that I want to mention here among the traditions of Prophet Muhammad about combat is always bury all dead, which means that if the enemy fled the battlefield, leaving their dead behind them, we cannot leave their dead unburied for the hyena to eat them or for the eagles. No, it is an obligation on a Muslim army to bury the dead of the enemy like they bury their own dead, respecting the tie between us, which is brotherhood in humanity. If they are not our brothers in religion, they are our brothers in humanity. And by the way, all what I mentioned is in the Geneva Convention. I challenge any one of your listeners now to go to the Geneva Convention and download it from un.org, www.unitednation.org, and see if there is anything more than what I mentioned. I'll give them $100. That was 1400 years before the Geneva Convention, and it's in the Islamic Sharia.
Few more points, Sheikh. We're almost out of time. There's such a vast this is such a vast topic, so much to cover.
But there's only one thing that's very important to mention here.
Please tell us.
Which is we said that jihad in the combat form is allowed when you want to establish justice, but I have to say that establishing justice should be always done through peaceful means in the beginning. So Muslims have always to try to establish justice through peaceful means. If they fail, they are then allowed to go for war. And this is crystal clear in the Quran, in the verse that says, and if they withdraw from you and fight not against you and offer you peace, then Allah has opened no way for you against them. Which means you cannot fight to establish justice unless you try all your best to establish justice through peaceful means. And this is in chapter number 4, verse number 90.
And are we talking about now this is for individuals, or are we talking that this is set up by a government, a state?
No. I'm speaking here about, it's generally. Actually, jihad should be performed under the banner of jihad, under the in a Muslim army, under an Islamic state that launches jihad when there is a need to launch jihad and establish justice. But we have also to mention that whenever there is a war, well, individuals can also participate under this banner. I don't deny that. But we have to stick very, very closely to these combat orders of Prophet Muhammad, or any violation to these orders of Prophet Muhammad will make it not jihad, but rather terrorism. Let me tell you something, because many crimes are committed under the banner of jihad. While it's not jihad, it's terrorism. At the same time, many crimes are committed under the banner of war on terrorism. While it is not war on terrorism, it is terrorism itself.
Tell us, Sheikh, before we wrap it up, just in short, tell us, we know that the last and final messenger sent to mankind, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as the Creator has said, Allah, that he was sent as a mercy to the world. And there are countless examples. I'm sure you can talk on this for days about all the merciful examples. But now some people, they try to make him out to be some warlord. Shortly, what do you have to say about this?
Let me tell you quickly, because we did not prove that the word jihad means war on terrorism. No, he was the most merciful human being on earth. And one of his teachings is, don't allow injustices to be there, and you have to fight it by all means. Number one, try to establish it through peaceful means, and if not, then you have to fight to remove these injustices. Quickly, talking about Islam, jihad being war on terrorism, if you just think with me, what is the difference between terrorism and violence? Violence is what two enemies practice directly against each other. While terrorism is violence, but not directly against the enemy. It's against the weak, to put pressure on the enemy indirectly. So those who committed the crime of 9/11, for example, they did not have a problem with those citizens themselves, but they had a problem with the American government. So by putting the weak people or unarmed people or civilians under pressure, they are putting pressure on the government itself. Same thing, even killing, civilians in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, there was no problem with those civilians, but it was to put those civilians under pressure in order to put pressure indirectly against the government of Japan itself. So here, terrorism is targeting the weak, and putting violence on the weak in order to put pressure on your enemy indirectly. God Almighty said in the Quran, in chapter number 4, verse number 75, and what is wrong with you that you fight not in the cause of Allah and for the weak, ill-treated and oppressed among men, women, and children? What did we say the weak are suffering from? Terrorism. So here Allah is saying, how come you don't fight terrorism? So jihad equals war on terrorism, not terrorism itself. But of course, I speak about the real war on terrorism.
Sheikh, in this last minute that we have, can you sum it up, and so the people will get a better understanding in the last minute that we have on what is Islam and what are the Muslims actually calling the people to?
Islam is the religion of justice. Justice should be established through peaceful means. If justice cannot be established through peaceful means, unfortunately, Muslims will have to go to war. But number one, peace has to come as the first choice always. Peace and war are two means to establish justice. The first mean and the best mean is peace itself. God Almighty, actually, among his names is peace. And Prophet Muhammad warned us from the worst two names. And he told us, don't name your children after those two names. The first one is war and the other one is bitterness. So what do you think about a religion that teaches its followers that the best name, one of the divine names, is peace and the worst name is war? Is it promoting peace or war? Of course, it's promoting peace. One of the chapters of the Quran is called the manifest victory. And it starts like that. Surely we have granted you a manifest victory. And guess in which battle was this victory? It wasn't in any battle. It was a peace treaty called Al-Hudaybiyah peace treaty. So what do you think, again, about a religion that calls a peace treaty a manifest victory? Is this a religion of peace or a religion of war? It's definitely a religion of peace. But at the same time, Muslims should not watch injustices in the world like that and just act passively.
Sheikh, thank you very much. We're out of time. Inshallah, God willing, we'll have you back to help answer some more questions and clear up the many misconceptions about this beautiful way of life, the way of life of all the messengers of God that called to acquire peace by submitting to the owner of peace, the creator of the heavens and earth. I'd like to thank you, and may God Almighty Allah reward you for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Peace be unto you. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Fresh, pure, holy peace. Fresh, pure, holy peace.